All right, so we're going to talk about these intertwiners, right? So what are intertwiners? Do you know what intertwiners are?
No, sir.
No. So let me tell you what intertwiners are. You know what a spin network is?
The thing that we drew in the LQG class, right? So
a spin network is a graph, basically, right?
And it has a little g for every edge.
What is that little g?
The element of the Lie group.
No, well, that little g is a holonomy. Okay. So it's an element of the group. So you assign, so this is your graph. Okay, this is your. And so we assign to each edge an element of SU2. Right. So now our state can be written as a functional of these holonomies. Right. So it's like saying that you have basically, if you have n particles, so for n particles, how would you write down the quantum state? The state would be written it's a function on the configuration space, right? On the configuration space. On the classical configuration space. So for n particles, what is your configuration space? Your configuration space is let's say Rn for n particles moving in one dimension. And so your state would be some function of n particles, of n this thing, right? Okay. This is a many body state, right? So for instance, you know, I mean, it could be written as some product of states like this, right? It could be, or
yeah,
with you could symmetrize it. You could anti-symmetrize it, etc. Right? But all of those things would still be functions of this psi, right?
Yes.
Right. So now, in this case, what is our classical configuration space for connection gravity, right? The classical configuration space. We can take it to be the space of connections, right?
Okay.
You know what a connection is, right?
It's like AMU, right?
Right.
Huh.
Right, which are Lie algebra value one form. Right, basically they are just fields living on the space. which take values in the Lie algebra.
Hmm.
Or equivalently, instead of directly working with these connections, we can take it to be the space of holonomies along one dimensional curves where a holonomy, you have some curve. You have the time for this? I don't know if this is going to...
Yes, sir, yes. No, I mean, I'm not doing anything.
So you have some curve, right, which goes from A to B, let's say. Then you say that the holonomy associated with this curve, right, is the path ordered exponential of A mu I, then tau I, dx mu, right? So this is if you have an abelian connection, for instance, this is just the electromagnetic phase that you get due to the vector field, right? This A is just your electromagnetic vector field in that case. In gravity, it's a SL2C connection or an SU2 connection when you do the Hamiltonian split, right? And this P means path ordering, right? And this is required because if you don't have this, then when you do this exponential, you will double count. The integrals will do a double count over the path. So I'm not going to go into the details of the path ordering. That can be left for that can be looked up somewhere else. So, and what is this? This is an element of SU2. It's basically a group element, right? You're taking an exponential of the Lie algebra, right?
Huh.
I mean, that's what it is, right? I mean, right? So yes. this is some theta I. And so you would write this as exponent of minus tau I theta. So this belongs to SU2, right? It's some element of SU2. And I guess I'm missing some factor of I here, probably. Which should be. Now, right now, so we say that our configuration space, instead of, so what should be our functions then, our wave function? What should they be, right? So if you take your your configuration space to be connections, and if you take it to be holonomies, then your configuration variable here is a field from your manifold to SU2. And in this case, it's a map. A holonomy is a map from some one dimensional curve, right? So it's a holonomy is a map from gamma to SU2, where gamma is some subset of M. Right? I mean, and gamma is, you can say, it's homeomorphic to the unit interval. Then what are your states if you write this, then your states would be functionals of your connections. Right? So that means if you are given one configuration, one connection. Right? So if you have some arbitrary state psi, okay? So let me give you the example here. So for instance, when I would write, when I write psi of x, that means what? X psi, right? It means I have some state psi, I take the projection of the state on the some position eigenstate, right? Similarly, I would say that I have some something like this, which are, let's say, call them connection eigenstates. Right? Meaning this state is, right? This state represents, corresponds to when your field is in the, is in this configuration, AI. Whatever that field. So the same way that when we say X, this means that the particle is quote unquote at X. Right? Or the position eigenvalue is X. Right? This is what we mean, right? When we say that. So similarly here, you would have some state psi, right? And then you would say that psi of this A mu I would be something like this. Something like this, right? So here you get functions of X, here you get functionals of the connection field, right? Okay. Here, what you would get here, what would your states be? Here, your states are your eigens, you have your holonomies. So, the eigenstates would be, let's say, something like G gamma. But now the thing is that this corresponds to, this is defined only on one dimensional curves. Right? Whereas you have a three-dimensional manifold whose geometry you want to describe, no? Okay. So how should you construct this state? So if you say state psi, what do? Well, you imagine that you take your manifold. And then you, take your manifold, and then what you do is, you sprinkle it with edges. Right? You sprinkle it with edges. Now these one-dimensional surfaces, these can be closed, these can be open, these can have intersections, these can be knotted, they can be linked. All sorts of possibilities are there, right? And then whatever is for each edge, each edge represents the state corresponding to that edge, that path, gamma. And then what is your state? Your state corresponding to that would be written as something like where this is your full state of your geometry, of your field, and then when you project it onto this, what do you get? You get a function of the holonomy.
Hmm.
I mean, this is just a very roundabout way of saying something which is not very deep.
Hmm.
So these are your position variables, right? These are your configuration variables.
Yeah,
But now, because they are one-dimensional, what you have to do is you have to sprinkle the manifold with lots of such . So the question is, how do you reconstruct3D or quote unquote bulk geometry from 1D holonomies? Okay. So in this case, you don't have a problem. If you work with your connections as your configuration variables, you don't have a problem.
Hmm.
Because these are defined on your manifold itself, right?
Hmm.
So, but the problem is that quantum theory in terms of these is very difficult. It's intractable.
Hmm.
So quantum theory in terms of holonomies is tractable. For one thing, they are gauge invariant variables.
Mm.
So that aspect is already taken into account. And gauge invariance has to be present, right? So,
mm.
And then the second thing is that you want to consider diffeomorphism invariant theory.
Mm.
Now these holonomies are diffeomorphism invariant variables. And they are also, I mean, one could say that this is also how do these, right? So under a diffeomorphism, what happens is there is a relationship between diffeomorphisms and gauge transformation.
Okay.
So when you perform a diffeomorphism on your manifold, this connection undergoes a gauge transformation.
Okay.
So these states are no longer invariant.
Hmm.
But because these holonomies are already gauge invariant.
Hmm.
I mean, sorry, not the holonomies. The traces of the holonomies are gauge invariant.
Okay.
The traces are if you take a matrix and you take the trace of that matrix, that quantity is invariant under similarity transformation.
Hmm.
So the gauge variance of the holonomies is also very straightforward. The gauge variance of the holonomy is the holonomy changes in this way. So if you have a gauge transformation, so what is a gauge transformation? It is a map from the manifold, from each point of the manifold. It's a map from SU to M. That means you assign an element of the group SU2 to each point of M. This is what is a gauge transformation.
Mm.
So I write it like, well, G. So you have some point A and B. Now, I don't want to get too sidetracked. I want to talk about intertwiners at the end of the day. So, but I've mentioned this gauge transformation thing. So let me just complete this small bit.
So I have one question. Sir.
Yeah.
So if you're assigning a gauge, an element of the Lie group to each point of the manifold, shouldn't the map be the other way around? I mean, why is it this way around?
I guess so. I guess so. I mean,
okay,
it's a you're right.
Okay.
It's an SU2 valued, not a Lie algebra, but a group valued map, right?
Yeah, group. Okay. Huh.
So then you would have a group element which lives at A and a group element which lives at B. And then G gamma, the holonomy going from A to B, transforms as in this way. You have it transforms in this way. So this is the tail and this is the head, or this is the source vertex, and this is the target vertex. And so if you take two such edges, let's say, and you combine them, so you have gamma 1, gamma 2. So what will happen? G gamma 1 will become UA inverse G gamma 1 UB, and G gamma 2 will become UB inverse G gamma 2 UC. Now the holonomy along the whole curve, right? This is AB, this is BC. The holonomy along the combined combination, what will it be? It will just be the product of the two holonomies, right? So the total holonomy will be G gamma 1 times G gamma 2. Or will it be the other way around? I think
it will be gamma 1, gamma 2.
No, because the way to think about a group element, what is the action of this holonomy is that you have some state psi. And when you reach this point, it becomes some state psi prime. And so we say that psi prime is equal to G gamma psi.
Okay.
Right. So this guy has to act first, and then this guy has to act second.
But then this.
Because if you're taking a state from here to here, so you're taking a state psi, and then psi prime, and then from here to here, psi double prime, let's say. So first, G gamma 1 has to act on psi. That gives you psi prime, and then G gamma 2 has to act on psi prime. Okay? So it has to, composition has to be in this order. And so this will go to G gamma 2 will go to UB inverse G gamma 2 UC, and things are not working out. They've changed. I made a mistake. So let me fix that. This is called iterative research. So this has to be
B inverse.
Yeah. UB. UB inverse G gamma UA. Again, because of the action from on a state, you have to think about the action on this state. So which one acts first? UA acts on it. UA acts on it, then it's parallel transported by G gamma. And then UB inverse acts on it when it reaches this point. So let me correct these two. UB inverse G gamma 1 UA, UC inverse G gamma 2 UB. Right? So So now if you combine these two, what do you get? You get UC inverse G gamma to UB. Right? That is G gamma 2, right? Times G gamma 1, which is UB inverse G gamma 1 UA, which is equal to UC inverse G gamma 2 G gamma 1 UA. So, because this UB inverse, this UB inverse will become the identity, right? So, so this is how the how holonomies combine. Now the thing is that if you want to work with these holonomy, this, so this is called a loop representation. If you want, if the, with the loop representation, things become very complicated. If you want to define, if you want to work with this, you have to define all sorts of operators which correspond to the linking of loops, knotting of loops, combining loops. And then that algebra is very complex. I mean, it's not, okay, it's not very tractable. So for example, you have two loops like this, one loop like this. Then you have to define how do these loops connect with each other. So you have to define something which goes like this, you know, all kinds of possibilities are there. So this becomes very, very tedious. And complicated. Loop algebra, right? So there is a better way to work with it, which is called the spin network representation, right? So this uses the Peter Weyl theorem, which is nothing more than Fourier transform on a group.
Okay.
It really is nothing more than a Fourier transform. Sometimes, many times in physics, you will see people use the phrase nothing more than this or nothing more than that. And then you'll be like, well, you know, for you, it's not nothing more, right? But here it actually is. So if you are comfortable with Fourier transforms, then you have no issue, right? So okay, for instance, if you have a state psi of x, right? For again, for single particle, you would write it as, you would say that, well, there is some basis of states. Let's say e to the minus I kx, psi k dk, right? You might say something like this. Right? What is this? This is just a fancy way of writing this in a different basis. This is just a different basis, right? So you have some, either you have some sum over some index k, or an integral over that index k. Right? So it's just a different basis. But what happens in that basis is that, so because of this Fourier transformation, derivatives in one basis become products in the Fourier transform basis, right? Right. So if I take d by d dx of psi of x, then what happens if you get 1 by root 2 pi, when you take d by dx, you get ik. Right? So now instead of this derivative becomes a multiplication by the momentum. Derivative with respect to a variable becomes multiplication by the dual variable, right? So if you have a differential equation, it becomes an algebraic equation when you do the Fourier transformation. It becomes a characteristic equation.
Okay.
Which you then solve for the dispersion relation, etc. And then you plug it back in and...
Okay.
Right? So, I mean, because if you have a differential equation like this, psi prime plus k psi is equal to something, k psi, then if you do the Fourier transformation, in the Fourier basis, this will become minus k square psi k. So let's sort of k, let me call it something else. M plus I M K psi K is equal to E times psi K. Right? And then this would correspond to the equation. You can take psi K common, you get minus K square plus I M K is equal to E. Right? And then this becomes your characteristic equation. You solve for k as a function of e, let's say, and then you plug that back in and you get the full solution, right? K as a function of e x. And then psi k, these are some arbitrary coefficients, which are, these are determined by the boundary condition. Right? So, now what do we have? We have our, in the connection representation, we have our states, which are functions of holonomies. So, what we do is, holonomies are what? Our states, psi g, these are functions on SU2, right? So what we do is we do the Fourier transform of functions on SU2. These are functions of SU2, right? So when we do this Fourier transform, what will be our momentum variable? You can probably guess.
The algebra.
More precisely?
The connection variables.
The spins. The spin representation. Spin. The J label.
Okay.
The J label.
Okay. SU2.
the J label, right? For any group, not just for SU2, for any compact, technically, I think, semi-simple group.
Okay.
And what will happen then is, you remember these derivatives? So in our constraint, in our equation, in our constraint equations for Hamiltonian diffeomorphism and all that, we have two fields. We have the connection fields and we have the this co-triad, the densitized co-triad, right? So when you write the quantum theory, what you do is you replace the same way that in the Hamiltonian for a particle. So what happens for the Hamiltonian of a particle? You have H is equal to P square by 2m, right? And you know that X and P satisfy this Poisson bracket. So the operators satisfy this bracket. So what you do in the theory is you replace you write H is, let's say, P square by 2m, and then you replace P with a minus IH bar D by D, right? And this gives you your Schrodinger Hamiltonian, right? Now, your states are functions of psi of x. And now you do the Fourier transform of psi of x. You write states in terms of their momenta. When you write states in terms of their momenta, your equations of motion become algebraic equations. You solve for the momenta, you plug things back in, you have solved the system. Right?
Yes, sir.
There can be a potential term and all. And there can be other more complicated terms also, but this is the, broadly speaking, this is the procedure. So now for gravity, our Hamiltonian is what? It's a function of your connections and your this co-triad. And so if I write down the Hamiltonian for in the self dual, I'm just doing it for simplicity because otherwise I have to remember all the other things. For the self dual, for the complex variable, so for the complex Ashtika connection, with non-zero lambda, what does your Hamiltonian constraint . So let me put all this on the next page. Your Hamiltonian constraint takes the form it looks something like this, right? FAB EA J EBK epsilon IJK. It looks something like this, right? Now, if you look at the symplectic structure, this is called the symplectic structure, right? The post of brackets. So if you look at the symplectic structure, you have and then these are fields. So you have to write them as fields, which could be defined at different points on the manifold, right? At x and x prime. First of all, you'll get delta x minus x comma x prime. Then you'll get delta ab delta ij, right? This is quote unquote what is called the symplectic structure. And now this symplectic structure, by the way, this appears sounds like a very mysterious thing, because you don't seem to be taught, this doesn't seem to be covered in usual mechanics courses, and there is generally a gap in our treatment of field theory and mechanics. And then researchers in field theory somehow magically know what the symplectic structure is. It turns out that, you know, then one has to either be part of the secret cabal, which knows what this is. Mm-hmm. But actually, it's nothing very complicated. It's just a Poisson bracket. There is more to it than that, but for our purposes, this is all that is needed. So in the quantum theory, we would say that similarly, right? Something like this, let's say, right? And again, so these have to be right. So then what you would do is, again, the minimal substitution. This rule would say that you take your Hamiltonian operator, right? This guy, this is your operator, right? You take this operator, and what you do is you put hats on everything, right? So to speak. And according to the minimal substitution rule, what do? You say that this quantity is equal to I h bar functional derivative with respect to AI, right? This is just like in the case of a scalar field. Right? It's the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Only now you have to worry about things like gauge invariance and all. Fine. So what will happen to your Hamiltonian? Your Hamiltonian will become minus something, minus h bar squared epsilon ijk FIAB delta A. Yeah. And delta A BK like this. Right? So we have gone from this Hamiltonian up, right, to this. Okay. Now this Hamiltonian, we'll say it acts on states like this to give us zero. We solve this and we get a theory of quantum gravity. That's the idea, right? Now remember that we want to define states not in terms of our connections directly, but in terms of holonomies. So when we define things in terms of holonomies, things become functions of on SU2. Right? Now the thing is that when we do this, take these derivatives of these states, right? So what we want to do is we want to take the derivatives of these states, right? Of the holonomy wave function. Right? That's what this psi is, right? So to do this, what do? We write this as a, in terms of the, using the Peter Weyl theorem, we Fourier transform it and we write it as a function of the spin representation, the sum over C spin representation.
Okay.
Then what happens is this derivative just becomes corresponds to the action of this derivative on such functions, on holonomy specifically, it corresponds to, so you can write this as delta psi g gamma by delta g gamma. Delta G gamma by G K. You can write it like this. And then this quantity, once you write this in terms of your spin labels, this just becomes equal to the action of your SU2 operators. Acting on your state.
Okay.
So when you combine all of this, this becomes
okay.
This in very in broad strokes is what is happening, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so here, for instance, when you want to write down what is the full state of a free particle, you would have to sum over all momentum states. Similarly, if you want to write down the full state. Or you want to write down, yeah, then you would have to sum over all momentum states, corresponding momentum states. So when you want to write down psi of G, you have to sum over all the spin representations. Now let me Just the spin network representation. And so now I can tell you what the Peter Weyl theorem is. I don't know, is this making sense? Like so far, once you get the complete picture, then, I mean, I haven't given the complete picture yet, but whatever I have done so far, is that sort of making sense?
I'm sorry, you're getting cut. Can you repeat that?
I said, whatever I have done so far, covered so far, is that sort of making sense?
I think so. I mean, I would have to go through it once.
Okay, that's enough. That's enough.
Yeah,
that's enough for me. I'll take that. So the Peter Weyl theorem says that if you have the function over a group, so G is a group element. This can be written as a sum over. So let me write this down. Pj. MM prime DJ MM prime G. It can be written in this way, where these are your, you can call them your Fourier coefficients, and these are your quote unquote plane waves.
Okay.
So, like you would say, psi of x, or you would say, yeah, you would say psi of x is equal to sum over k, psi k n e to the I k n x, something like this, in the discrete case. So these are your Fourier coefficients. And these are your plane waves. All right.
So you're writing the dual variable also as G?
No, I'm writing it as this. The dual variable is this J.
Okay.
Right, and this thing, okay, it has to be a function. And what is this DJMM? Right? These are the matrix elements. So MM prime are the elements of the matrix. They label the elements of the matrix of the group element in the jth representation of SU2. And what is the dimension of the jth representation? It's 2j plus 1. So these indices m and m prime, they take values in 1 to 2j plus 1.
Okay.
Right? So for example, and j takes values in Z positive integers by 2, right? And now remember that these plane waves, they satisfy an orthogonality relation, right? And if we don't have this orthogonality relation, then the Fourier basis will not be that useful. So we have this, right? One way to write it is in this way. Right? This is the plane wave orthogonality relationship, right? So if you know this relationship, then you can extract the, so if you look at the state, if you look at this state, and you write this as you can extract this guy by taking the inner product of psi with a plane wave, right? So you get the nth Fourier coefficient, right? The same way, so if you want psi of k, what do? You take k and psi, right? So similarly, what we have is, and these are both functions of G. Well, I think there might be some 2 pi factors or something. So it's like this. And in terms of so it becomes DJMM prime G and then complex conjugate. Because your group elements can be complex valued. Right? Your Lie algebra also has complex valued elements, right? So your group elements can also be complex valued. They are complex valued, right? And this is the integration over the whole group. And this is called something called the Haar measure. So you have to be a little bit careful in defining what this is, because the group has certain properties. This is actually, this dx is the Haar measure on the real line. The real line is a group, right? So this is just the appropriate, it has to be invariant under group transformation. So anyway, so when you do this, this is delta J J prime, delta M M prime, delta N N prime. So this means that you can take any psi of G. Light has gone.
Yeah, far cut.
You can light any psi of G and write it as a superposition of these CJ MM prime. Now these are your coefficients and DJ MM prime. This is your Fourier basis or Peter Weil basis. And the sum is over J M and M prime. And this thing is called the Great Orthogonality Theorem. I think it's called the second Great Orthogonality Theorem. There are two of those.
Okay.
So one applies to the matrix elements, one applies to the traces of the matrices. Those, the trace of a group matrix is called a character. So one is a character orthogonality, one is a. So the point is now that if you have any edge which is labeled by some by some holonomy, and corresponding to that holonomy, you write down some function of that edge, which is your quantum state. Then you can write this quantum state as a superposition of you can write it as a superposition over these matrix elements, where now you are summing over these coefficients. So, and what is this? This AB, here, now this AB represents your DJMMG. So this is your dual in some ways. So when we write this this G, schematically you can write it as like this.
Okay, huh.
Sum over J. So this is how you write holonomies in terms of spin labels. Now what happens is that your loops can intersect also. You can have intersecting loops. So if you have intersections, right, then so first of all, for your graph, okay, so before that, so now our graph state, right, this state, it can be written as a sum over spin labels, right? So our graph state can be written as a spin over sum labels, right? With these coefficients m1, m1 prime, cj2, m2, m2 prime, so on, cjn, mn, mn prime times dj1 m1 m1 prime g1 dj2 m2 m2 prime g2 like this, and you're summing over all the J's, all the M's and the M primes. Better like this. Right. And now, so instead of writing your graph as this guy, now what you do is you have the same graph structure But now your edges are labeled by spin label. Now what happens is that when you have these edges, they can meet in vertices also. So the thing is, how do you define this the state in a way? So now we can finally come to our, so you understand where the spin part comes from in the spin network. So now we can finally talk about intertwine. Okay, so what are these? So when you have, let's say, edges which meet at a vertex, right? There are spin labels J1, J2, and J3. Okay. Now, these J1s, these J's, they have to satisfy some consistency relationships. So basically, if you're looking at a trivalent vertex like this, then you have to have something like this. J1 plus J2 has to be less than or equal to J3. J2 plus J3 has to be less than or equal to J1. These are basically the, so what you have is you have angular momenta, right? That's what this is, J. J is the angular momentum. You have some angular momentum that is coming into an edge, into a vertex, sorry. So in order for your vertex to be gauge invariant, your angular momenta should add up to zero, right? So whatever comes in should equal whatever is going out. That is what this is, right? This is just a rule for addition of angular momentum. So J1 plus J2 should add to give you J3 and so on. That, and for that to be possible, these inequalities need to be satisfied.
Okay.
Now, the thing is that, so in this case, there are no, this vertex doesn't really have any freedom. There's no independent degree of freedom for the vertex itself.
Okay.
So if you ask what is the Hilbert space associated with the vertex, okay? Now to understand this, you have to go back to that in either the last or the second last lecture of my LQG lectures, I had talked about how you can take the edges and how you can take each edge and label associated with two different spins, a source spin and a target spin. Right, so let me just go back to those MQG lectures. Yeah. So this is your, this is your function on the group. This is the Peter-Weyl decomposition. right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, when you look at this quantity, this DJMM, right? This MM is valued in 2J plus 1, right? 1 to 2J plus 1. So what does this DJ act on? It acts on a state which lives in the fundamental representation. Well, not, yeah, in the fundamental representation of SU2.
Okay.
Well, in the spin J representation of SU2. So for instance, if J is equal to 1/2, then this thing acts on a spin 1/2 vector, right? Which has two components. And it gives you another spin 1/2 vector. Right? So you can think of this as an element of H-half tensor H-half. Right? Because if you have any matrix, if you have a matrix A with indices MN, which take values in 2J plus 1 and 2J plus 1, then you can take that matrix and you can contract it with two different states. One state living in H of J and the other state living in H J, and get a number. So you can think of that matrix itself as an element of this living in this tensor product space. Right? This is probably not completely manifestly clear. So let me clarify that here. In the lectures, you know, I had to cover a lot of material, and so I had to take some things for granted, you know, so I couldn't describe every single thing. See, it's like this. Let's say that you have what is HJ tensor HJ, right? It is a set of all states, right? Psi belongs to HJ. HJ implies that this psi can be written as a sum of right, where phi I is a basis of HJ, right? This is a basis state, right? Now, I'm not trying to break Nima's record, but I think I've gone on for a pretty long time. Should I stop here for now?
It's up to you, sir. I mean, I'm just listening.
Do you have the energy to continue?
I do, but like I have guests at home.
Huh?
I do. I mean, I would like to listen, but I have guests at home.
Oh, you have guests. Okay. You have to go take. So I'll stop here for today. And my battery is also running low. And I have absolutely no aspirations to, I do not aspire to Nima's levels of stamina. I mean, I think that is almost, depending on the way you look at it, either a divine energy or a demonic energy. So I have no aspiration to either one. I'm very happy in the middle class on Middle Earth with all the hobbits. So we'll continue this in the next session, and I'll stop the recording now. Okay.
Sure, sir.
But do you have any questions before I stop?
No.
Okay. So So good thing I recorded this. It will form a nice attendance to the lecture. And then in the, so you go over this, and then tomorrow we'll have our next session on this.
Yes, sir.
If you have time. And I want to finish this talking about what intertwiners are.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. Okay. So take care.
Yes, sir.
I'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye.
Sure, sir.